فيها وهم فيها لا يبخسون. آمنا بالله صدق الله والعلي العظيم. Continuing with our subject, I just wanted to recap while we kind of wait for the hall to fill in a bit, to recap what we've done so far, inshallah ta'ala, which is that every night we've been looking at a different aspect of beauty in Islam. Right, and when I began this series, I mentioned that one of the most important, you know, words in the Quran is beauty. But it's manifested in so many ways in the Quran, right? And we've been looking at every night at a different aspect of beauty, from different angles, not the same topic, from different angles. We look at the beauty of the character of the Prophet, we look at beauty of the patience of Fatima Zahra, we've looked at pseudo-beauty, and we're going to come back to that tonight. And we're looking at it from a variety of angles. Right? Because there are two kinds of beauty and two kinds of love in the Quran. There's real beauty, which is what we should strive for, what we should strive to be, what we should work towards, and then there's false beauty, pseudo-beauty. There's real love, pure love, and then there's profane love, impure love, meaning loving things for the wrong reasons. So for example, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us in the Quran about what is the example of this false love. Someone who falls in love with someone who doesn't share the same faith. لَوْعَجَبَتْكُمْ, for example. That even if she amazes you, and you meet her, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us this in the Quran, right? That even if you're amazed by her, you're dazzled, meaning you see beauty. Allah is saying it's not beauty what you see in front of her. That person is inviting you to hell. Right? Wallah yad'u ila jannah. But Allah is inviting you to paradise. But what you're seeing in front of you is a delusion. It's real in its physical sense, but spiritually it's a delusion. And they're inviting you to hell. So there's two da'wats in the Quran, in, you know, da'wah in Arabic with the ayn, of course. There are two invitations in the Quran. There's an invitation to heaven and an invitation to hell. There's an invitation to the true beauty, to hasten to the true beauty of Allah, of everything that's real, of everything that Allah has created in purity, and that is halal, that is tayyib, that is clean, that is good for us, that the Prophet has given us, that the Imam have given us. Then there is the gifts, so-called gifts, and the jaza of shaitan. The recompense and the rewards and the glitter of Satan and his followers and his minions and his people. Satan has an ahl and Allah has an ahl. Satan has a party and Allah has a party. The Quran, the narrative of the Quran, I would say from Fatiha to An-Nas is split along this duality. Real love, false love. Real beauty, false beauty. So in reality, the beautiful and the ugly. But the ugly presents itself as beautiful. So somebody, let's say, falls in love with the woman, or a woman fall in love with a man, right? The ayah in Surah Al-Baqarah brings both examples. And Allah goes deep into the depth of human psychology. It's so amazing here. What Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, He says that even if she is amazed with him, or he is amazed with her. Right? So what Allah is saying is that infatuation, obsession, can become a very big problem in someone's life. And that can be the slippery slope that leads them to the eternal damnation, to eternal problems in their life. Because they've never hastened towards what is real for them. In Surah Hud, the ayah that we began with today, Allah says, "Man kana yuridu al-hayata dunya wa zinataha, that the one who desires the life of this world and its beauty, its zenith, its ornament, نُوَفِّي إِلَيْهِمْ أَعْمَالَهُمْ, that whatever they want from this world will be given to them. نُوَفِّي إِلَيْهِمْ أَعْمَالَهُمْ فِيهَا, but only in this world. So if they want to enjoy this world, meaning enjoy this world in a way that Allah has said is not clean, not pure, not good for you, not halal, not tayyib, not righteous, then go ahead. Live your life in this world. And if you think that you can give money to charity or help out a food bank, go ahead. But know that whatever you do in this world, if it is outside of the parameters of the morality and the ethics and the behavior that Allah and His Messenger has asked you to do, then whatever good you think you have done will only stay in this world. There is no reward in the hereafter for it. There is no reward there for it. This is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying in Surah Al-Hud. And Allah says, rest assured, لَا يُبْخَسُونَ, there will be no shortage, no naqas. You want this world? We'll give it to you. Bismillah, come. أَهْلًا وَسَهْلًا وَمَرْحَبًا. You want it? Welcome. We'll give it to you. As Allah says in another ayah, وَفَتَحْنَا عَلَيْهِمْ أَبْوَابَ كُلِّ شَيْءٍ, and we open every door of enjoyment for them. Every door, if they really want it, we'll give it to them. But they know that they're selling their soul for it. Allah uses this may all over the Quran. ثَمَنًا قَلِيلًا, right? That they sell it for cheap. ثَمَنًا قَلِيلًا. And we know, see, for example, some of these singers and these, people, for example, Lennon writes, John Lennon, the famous singer of the band Beatles, says himself that he made a deal with the devil. In exchange for power and fame, he would give the devil his soul. This is very common. Because some people are desiring power, fame, admiration, attention, you know, whatever you want to call it. It's called the Faustian bargain. Faustian. The Faustian bargain. Go look it up. It's very well known. The Faustian bargain. It's called the deal with the devil. It's a very real thing. It's a literal thing. The Faustian bargain. That they make a deal. Allah refers to this in the Quran and many ayat. This is from Quran. Allah mentions this. Deals are made. Allah says, okay. But know that deal stays here. There's no execution. That's not going to transfer. Nothing what you think you're going to get here is going to go there. So today, I want to discuss a few things that are a bit sensitive. As I mentioned last night, the noble messenger of Allah has, guides us with the most beautiful character, with the most beautiful mercy. And a part of that beautiful shafaqah and care that he loves for us, that he has for us, is that he has warned us about the times to come, the days that will come ahead. This is a part of his love. It's because he loves us. It's because he loves us, okay? It's because he loves us that he warned us of certain uncomfortable truths. Some of these things may rattle a few of you tonight. It may shake some of you a little bit the wrong way. That's not my intention, but this is the minbar, and we impart what the Messenger of Allah imparts, what Imam Hussein imparts. And that's not my intention. My intention is to share what the Messenger of Allah has told us about the end of times. And not opine upon what I think is the end of times. He says, يَذْحَرُ فِيهِمْ سِمِنْ. Obesity will be flagrant and apparent among the people. We have many traditions about obesity. Many traditions that are signs of the end of times. Will be widespread obesity, widespread. And there's many reasons for this. We have another tradition from Imam As-Sadiq, وَرَأَيْتَ الرِّجَالِ يَتَسَمَّنُونَ رِدِ الرِّجَالِ وَنِسَاءِ النِّسَاءِ. This is a very interesting, because it doesn't literally mean obesity, but it means men would encourage men to a lifestyle of so much extravagance that encourages that kind of thing. And women would encourage women for such a lifestyle. That it's a lifestyle of overindulgence, a lifestyle of extreme extravagance, a lifestyle of overdoing it all the time. Overfilling all the time. It's also a lifestyle, yet a sammanun, it's a very interesting word because it's from simen. It means obesity. But here it also means, from Imam Sadiq, this is towards the end of times, the Imam says. He says, people will brag about what they don't have. Meaning their whole life will be built on credit. You know, I remember a good friend of mine, we were once at an Islamic center, and there was Beamers, Lambos, all kinds of cars lined up outside. Nothing less than six figures. I mean, 100,000 to start, right? And you're looking outside and you see all these big rides lined up. I remember a friend of mine nudged me. He says, bro, that's all on credit. Ain't nobody bought that in straight cash. Maybe one out of 1,000 of those cars is bought with cash. There's all on credit. 5%, 6% interest, 7% interest, 10%, whatever it is. And now it's even more problems. I don't know what the APR is here, but Toronto, it's tough. Times are tough. So here the Imam is saying, and it's interesting that the word is connected with getting fat, with obesity. Extravagance and obesity here come together, yet to semmanum. Because they don't got anything else to do. Their life is vacuous, it's empty, it's garbage. And on top of that, they don't even have real wealth. It's not even real wealth. It's all false. It's a delusion. It's all a show, the Imams. Yet a semmanun. Al-rijal wa nisa al-nisa. So the women in their gatherings and the men in their gatherings talk about things that they don't even have. They probably don't even own their own house. It's all on loan, isn't it? Someone else owns it. It's a mirage. The concept of wealth will become a mirage to people. And accompanied with that will be obesity. We'll return to the obesity a little bit later. So they don't have real wealth. It's all built on credit. As they say, it's built on a house of cards. Right? It's like a big Jenga piece, till a piece is pulled out from the bottom and everything starts coming down. This is about the end of times, Akhiru Zaman. But this lifestyle, this identity built on credit, extravagance, which leads to obesity, or at least partly, it's all indicative of the loss of identity as Muslims. This is what the Prophet's warning us about. The Prophet, Imam Ali, Imam As-Sadiq, so much Sunni, Shia. This is not a Sunni, Shia. This is a Muslim issue. وَمُحَارَبِيهِمْ نِسَاءَهُمْ. And men will become so fat and lazy that their women will fight for them. The Prophet says, "Muharibihum nisa'ahum." The women will be combatants. وَشَرَفُهُمَ الدَّرَاهِمُ وَالدَّنَانِيرُ. And their honor will lie in their money. Meaning they think that they can buy honor, that they can just buy what they want. And one of the signs of these days of extravagance, of the loss of manliness, of the loss of any sense of dignity of being a Muslim male, is that the women will begin to fight. The women will be combatants. You can judge it as you want, but this is a consensus among Muslims, Sunni and Shia sources. Kamal al-Din of Ibn Babu. I don't even need to go through the sources. Anyone who knows anything about Islam and the traditions related to this subject know this. This is not Sunni Shia. This is what we have been told about Akhiru Zaman, about the end of days. وَرَأَيْتَ الْمَلَاهِ كَدْ ذَحَرَتْ. And Imam al-Sadiq says, and you will see instruments everywhere, openly. يَمُرُّ بِهَا وَلَا يَمْنَعُهَا أَحَدٌ أَحَدًا. And no one will be able to stop this culture of concerts and musical instruments. وَلَا يَجْتَزِيُ أَحَدٌ عَلَى مَنْعِهَا. And no one will even bother to try to stop it. No one will be able to prevent this. Imam Ali tells us, Imam Sadiq tells us, so many traditions. That يَا أَيُّهَا الْمُسْلِمُونَ يَا أَيُّهَا الْمُسْلِمُونَ يَا أَيُّهَا الْمُسْلِمُونَ. Look out at the day when musical instruments will be flagrant in your Muslim societies, in your Muslim homes, in your Muslim gatherings. Not about kuffar, not about non-Muslims. This is not the issue about non-Muslims. No. The Prophet is not talking about this. The Prophet is speaking about my ummah. My ummah. Prophet, Imam Sadiq, Imam Ali. Come, all the sources are there. Too many to list. It's not one. Many, many, many traditions about the end of time in this regard. Imam Ali says, اتخذتي القيان والمعازف. People will resort to listening to female singers and musical instruments. About Akhiru Zaman again. In a very long khutbah that Saduq narrates in Ikmaluddin or Kamaluddin wa Tamamu Ni'ma of Ibn Babawi al-Qummi, Shaykh al-Saduq, you will see the long khutbah there of Imam Ali in that khutbah when he speaks about, O Muslims, O Shia, when those times come, know that you shall not be found in such places. And if you are, then you have the signs of nifaq and munafiqat and hypocrisy in your hearts. And you have no worthiness to even claim to be from me or to claim to be associated with me. I have nothing to do with you. You have nothing to do with me. Ma'a salama. I'm explaining what he's saying basically. No need to go through all the Arabic. There will be a group of people, the Prophet says, who dress strangely. Ar-rijal yatazayyanun bizinati nisa. There will be a group of men who will put on the zinat and the makeup of ladies. And Imam Ali says, men will dress as women and women will dress as men. All of them claiming to be Muslim. Where does all this come from? You know, I was reading an amazing book I recommend to many of you. It's called The Experience of God by David Bentley Hart. He's an Orthodox Christian. This book is published by Yale University. Bentley Hart says something so interesting about this world that Imam Ali is describing, Prophet is describing, Imam Sadiq is describing, alayhim as-salam. What does he say? He says, Bentley Hart says here, he says that now that the most violent storms of recent history have largely abated, meaning World War II is gone, people are enjoying themselves, and we're now in a spectacle of production and consumption. This is a spectacle. And a dialectic of ubiquitous banality. Do you know what this means? Meaning of just total evil. by which the insatiable economic culture of the late modern West is shaped and sustained, by an insatiable economic culture. He calls it the superstructure of consumerism. He says late modern society, it's principally concerned with purchasing things in ever greater abundance and variety, and so has to strive to fabricate an even greater number of desires to gratify and to abolish as many limits and prohibitions upon desire as it can. So whatever limits there are for desire, it needs to be removed. Such a society is already implicitly atheist, and so must slowly but relentlessly apply itself to the dissolution of transcendent values, of godly values. This has to be dissolved, get out of the way, because it stands in the way of these desires that Imam Sadiq, that Imam Ali, that the Prophet is describing. It cannot allow ultimate goods, meaning things that are connected to Allah, I began, right? The good life, the pure life, the clean life, tayyib. What is allowed through marriage, the pure marriage that Allah and His Messenger have allowed us. It cannot allow ultimate goods to distract us from proximate goods, from those things that we think are close and easy to attain quickly or temporarily. Our sacred writ, meaning our sacred constitution, is advertising. Our piety is shopping. Our highest devotion is private choice. My life, my choice. God and the soul too often hinder the purely acquisitive longings upon which the market depends. Meaning the problem is God and the soul. That's the problem. That's the only hindrance. You got to get rid of that. Or at least if you're going to keep it, make it in such a way that it doesn't get in the way of any of those things the Prophet has described, Imam Ali has described, Imam Sadiq has described. And confront us with values that stand in stark rivalry to the one true substantial value at the center of our social universe. And that is none other than the price tag. Give me the price. Name the price. Allah has already told us this in Quran. People will sell their souls left, right, and center to get ahead. For different reasons, for power, for desire, for whatever it is. And there are two parties. There's the party of God and the party of Satan. There's the party of ugliness and the party of beauty. The Prophet is telling us that these people will claim to be Muslim. Sallu ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. He goes on to say that the ulama of that time, or some of them of that at that time rather, will participate or facilitate or be in such a way that they don't stand in the way of the mu'mineen or the Muslims to ruin their spiritual lives. They'll say what needs to be said because it's what is agreeable to the centers of power, to the salateen of the age. They will read Quran in a decorative way, but in reality they don't prevent the Muslims from all the things that I have just described. Obesity. And that's both the symbolic and spiritual obesity, huh? We've already mentioned that. Musical instruments and those gatherings of singers and all that, those haram gatherings, those impure, disgusting, impure gatherings which are spiritually najis. This is all that the Prophet describes it this way, right? The Quran describes it this way. And a time will come where people will claim to be scholars who don't stand in the way of any of this. And they will also be people of wealth. Prophet goes on to describe these people. These people who claim to be Muslims at the end of time. Rakibun shahawat, he says. they will enjoy or rather partake in their desires, lusts. Tarikun al-jama'at. They will leave the communities. Jama'at here could be the community of prayer, the community of iman. This is what the prophets are referring. Tarikun jama'at. But one of the first signs is they'll be away from the communities where there is prayer, where there is remembrance of Allah, remembrance of the Messenger, remembrance of Ahlul Bayt. They will be away. Tarikun al-jama'at. Because that community reminds them of the things that are in opposition to their lusts, in opposition to their satanic passions. They either have a guilty conscience, they don't want it to weigh on them, or they've gone so far away that they just can't care anymore. Raqidun an al-atamat. They don't spend any of the night in prayer. That's what he's saying, meaning they sleep in the first third of the night. They're not Ahlul Ibadah. They're not the people of worship. Mufarratun fil ghadawat. Their mornings are wasted. There are people who, if you ask them, how do you live? Well, I sleep and get up. Well, where does worship come in? He says, these are these people at the end of time. Fi akhirat zaman. Raqidun an al-atamat. Then in that first third of the night, they're not partaking in anything worthy to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. These are all the signs, he says. So he says, O Muslims, he's talking to Abdullah ibn Mas'ud in particular, watch out for these things. A day will come. Abdullah ibn Mas'ud was shocked. He says, how could this be, Ya Rasulullah, that Muslims would waste the first third of the night? How? This is the level of some of the companions who, alhamdulillah, some of them were righteous, and this was their level of iman. They couldn't imagine a day that a Muslim would waste the night. What does day come? Mufarratun fil ghadawat? That time between Fajr and sunrise would also be wasted? What is there then in their spiritual life? Nothing. Bankruptcy, aflas. They have nothing to offer God. Zero. Khalas. The Muslims at that time were shocked. Like, it was like the Prophet was telling them, describing to them a world that they couldn't imagine as being a Muslim. Muslims not working hard, wasting their mornings. This is who Muslims are, according to the Prophet. Meaning the opposite of this is a Muslim. The converse of what I've just mentioned is what a Muslim is. A spiritual Muslim. Not just a Muslim by name. Because the Prophet says that they will claim to be Muslim. He says this many times. They will claim to be Muslim. They will claim to be Muslim. They will claim to be. They will say, Nahnu Muslimun. They will say this. He says, remember, Ibn Mas'ud, they will say this. But do not take their claims at face value. Do not befriend them, he says. Be careful with who you associate with, because those attributes and that lifestyle will rub off on you. This is the Prophet, Imam Ali, Imam Sadiq. There's so many. Go to Makarim al-Akhlaq of Tabarsi, it's there, translated into English, you can see it. This is what the Prophet has warned his Ummah about. The Prophet says that there are five people that Allah will not glance at on the Day of Judgment, meaning that His love will not be delivered to them. And He will not purify them. وَلَهُمْ عَذَابٌ أَلِيمٌ. And they will have a profound punishment. هُمَ النَّاعِمُونَ عَنَ الْعَتَمَاتِ. Those people who never bother, even, you know, whose nights are just wasted, basically. From the worship of Allah, the remembrance of Allah, something productive for Allah, basically. They would rather sleep than do something productive to get them closer to their deen. Meaning they're wasting the beautiful life that Allah has given them. وَالْغَافِلُونَ عَنَ الْغَضَوَاتِ. And those mornings, especially regarding to Fajr, are wasted. Allah will not show them any love. Because He's created them, He's given them this body, He's given them this brain, He's given them this beautiful universe, He's given them all these opportunities. And day after day after day after day, they squander every opportunity. Of course, Allah is Tawwabun Rahim. He is merciful and accepting of repentance. اللعبون الشامات بالشامات. It's interesting, and they're playing with swords. Basically, saying they're playing games. Their life is games. Could be today video games. Who knows what it's. They just play. Playing, playing, playing. Sharibun al-kahawat. Drinking alcohol. Kahwa here is not coffee. Kahawat here is alcohol. Salu ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. المتفكحون بشتم الآباء والأمهات. We read. They will be known as people towards this time who insult and make fun of their parents. Insulting, making fun, making deriding comments about their mother and their father. It is no coincidence that nearly every single TV show today has a deadbeat father, isn't it? A dim-witted, deadbeat, lazy, unproductive, unwise father. Not that it's true. I'm saying that's what's being presented. Nearly every single drama or show, at least in the West, not necessarily in the East, but in the West. The Prophet has told us this time would come. Again, people turned to the Prophet and they were shocked, they were in tears. Some traditions they were crying when he's saying this. This is musibat for them, this is tadumata. This is musibat. He said, how could a day come when the father and the mother do not have that respect? Or even worse, they've done something so terrible to not even have that respect. Men occupy the role as protectors, wise guides, benevolent leaders, compassionate teachers. This is what Islam teaches us. These are the attributes of Rijal, the men. This is Islamic tradition. Salu ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. So in reality, what the Prophet is saying is that their entire life is devoid of the moral, spiritual, ethical principles of Islam. They may have Muslim names or outwardly profess to be Muslims. But he says, when we look at the lifestyle, at the habits, at the language that they use, the relationship with their spouses or their homes, women to men and men to women, as we began with, it's not just men, it's both. It takes two to tango, in the haram tango, two. It takes two. Roaming the night, dressing strangely, attending musical gatherings. Then he quotes Surah Maryam 59. This ayat sends shivers. I've been reading the same verse for years. Look at what Maryam 59 says. Allah Ta'ala tells us. فَخَلَفَ مِنْ بَعْدِهِمْ خَلْفٌ. A generation will come after. أَضَاعُوا سَلَاتَ. They shall abandon or leave behind the prayer. There's two interpretations to this: constantly delaying the prayer or missing the prayer altogether. وَاتَّبَعُوا شَهَوَاتِ. And they will be going into their desires, their lusts. So one of the first thing that falls off is the five prayers. That's the alarm bell. That's the alarm. As soon as the five prayers stop falling off. Okay, we all make mistakes. We miss here and there. We're human beings. But here with Ada'u Salat, meaning constantly, constantly. All the time. We're human beings. We make mistakes. Okay, make it up. But here Allah's saying that it will be a generation of people who no longer pray like the generation that came before. Meaning your kids or your grandkids, do they pray the five prayers as you pray them? If they don't, the Prophet is saying, alarm bell, five alarm bell, fire alarm. Because at the end of times, there will be two groups of people. There will be the blessed and there will be the miserable. Al-ashqiya wal-ghuraba. There will be the estranged. Wutuba lil-ghuraba, the Prophet says. They will be blessed. And then there will be the wretched ones. Al-ashqiya. And he says, I cry for the wretched ones at the end of time. I cry for them. Out of pity. That if only they lived that pure life. They knew what Islam has to offer them in terms of cleanliness of heart, cleanliness of life. La ilaha illallah, being attached to God who gives them that sense of purpose and light and happiness in their life. Allah says, فَصَوْفَ يَلْقَوْنَ غَيًّا, that their reward of their perversity and their sin will be given to them. They will need it. Those who came after, who abandoned the prayer and follow their desires. Surah Maryam, ayah 59. Sallu ala Muhammadin wa ali Muhammad. And it goes without saying, illa man taba, except the one who repents. Allah's door of repentance is always open. As Imam Sadiq says, the weeping of the repentant one is more beloved to Allah than the constant worship of the one who worships. Aninul Muthnibin. The weeping of the one who cries to Allah is more beloved to Allah than the one who just worships their whole life. Ibn Mas'ud, أَجْسَادُهُمْ لَا تَشْبَى وَقُلُوبُهُمْ لَا تَخْشَى تَخْشَى. He says, O Ibn Mas'ud, their tummies, their bodies will never be satisfied and their hearts will not fear God and have that love, loving awe of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Their lords will be their tummies. بُطُونُهُمْ أَلِحَتُهُمْ. Their tummies will become their gods. Amazing, huh? Their stomachs will be their gods. But wait a second, they believe in more than one, they believe in one God, no? Why is the Prophet saying that their tummies will be their gods? Their tummies. Of course, it's symbolic of extravagance, of wealth, of desire, of lust, of this constant rat race which is never satisfied. Until they end up at a point in their life and they look back and they say, what have I accomplished? You know, I remember a brother calling me, just to put this in perspective, a little short, very short story, but I think it'll kind of give perspective to it. Brother once calls me and he says to me, Assalamu alaikum, Maulana. I said, Wa alaikum salam. He says to me, I have this problem with my son. I said, okay, what is it? And he went on and explained the problem, something about son fell in love with a woman that's not Muslim, not, you know, Shia, this and that, and we want to have the nikah. And I said, you can't do it, you can only do it in temporary marriage, according to Ayatollah Sistani. He says, yeah, but they want to get married permanently. I said, I don't do such. If you want to find someone else, it's fine. I don't do those nikahs, those marriages. He said, but Maulana, she's a lawyer. I said, okay. Yeah, but you know which firm she works in? My son has MA. I said, okay. Okay, fine. And he went on listing both their CVs to me. I patiently listened to both their resumes to be listed out to me. Their JD, their MAs, or whatever it is that they have on their resumes. Both very accomplished men and women in their own respective fields of professional business. And I told him, my dear brother, what does any of this have to do with the mas'ala I've just presented to you? I'm really sorry. The one has nothing to do with the other. What was the purpose of you spilling this to me? How does one have anything to do with the other? He said, no, but you know. I said, no, you know what? Like, what are you trying to tell me here? I don't understand. I said, maybe you yourself don't even understand what you're saying. Sometimes this has to be said. You have to be honest with someone. Like, bro, you're sipping your own Kool-Aid. You are drunk on your own ideas of what you think the world should be. You're just deluded yourself into thinking that this is okay because, oh, they're both lawyers and they're both this and they're both that. And I said, you've called someone. I said, if you want to call a psychologist or a secular doctor or whatever, I said, fine. I said, you're calling someone who's an expert, you know, someone who talks about religion. What do you expect me to, how does that have anything to do with that? This is exactly what the Prophet is telling us. This is exactly what Amir al-Mu'mineen is telling us. This is exactly what Imam Sadiq is telling us, is that a time will come where this is how Muslims will think. This will be the level of the poverty of the conversation. Like, the conversation will be at this level in the dirt. Asfala safilin, as Allah says. Lowest of the lowest. Bottom of the barrel, as Allah says. And people will somehow think that these things matter when it comes to halal and haram. When it comes to what's pleasing to Allah and His Messenger and the Ahlul Bayt. The Prophet continues, he says, يَبْنُونَ الدُّورُ وَيُشِيدُونَ الْقُسُورِ. They will build big buildings and castles. And they will decorate their masjids. And their only desires of when they do all these capital projects. هِمَّتُهُمْ لَيْسَتْ هِمَّتُهُمْ إِلَّا الدُّنْيَا. Their himmah, their desires will be nothing but this world. These will all be personal pet projects. As a kind of demonstration of a grandeur or a kind of reflection of their larger than life ego. They will decorate masjids. They will build large buildings. They will build castles in their own honor. And all of this, the Prophet says, I have nothing to do with Allah. I think this is pretty prophetic, isn't it? Sallu ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. Bringing me to obesity now. There's an article by Sultan Ali Noher in the International Journal of Health Sciences. In case someone says, oh, this must be written by a non-Muslim. No, it's written by a Muslim in the Gulf. Kuwait is affected the worst with 42.8% obese population. Almost identical to the United States per capita. This places Kuwait in the top 10 most obese countries in the world, very quickly followed by Saudi Arabia and Qatar. Iraq and Lebanon have very similar statistics right behind them in the high 30s, mid 30s to the mid 40s. United States, Mexico, and Canada are nearly identical, slightly higher. Exploding numbers of type 2 diabetes, exploding numbers of cardiothoracic issues, exploding numbers also of divorce. exploding numbers also of unhappy relationships, exploding numbers also of the consumption of inappropriate content. Did you know when you go, this is a sad fact, that when the IP, those internet protocol companies or whatever, do these statistics of who accesses this inappropriate material the most, unfortunately, astaghfirullah, Rabbi wa atubu ilayh, in like the top 5-7 countries, 10 countries, 2 or 3 of them are Muslim nations. And I don't want to name those, because if anyone's from those nations, I don't want them to feel like I'm picking on anybody. But big Muslim countries. And they have the name Jumhuriya Islamiya, even some of them, Islamic Republic, because they all have this name now. Welcome to bandwidth, huh? High bandwidth. High bandwidth sin. Fiber optic guna. It's sad. I remember, you know, reading, you know, that there was a crisis of public consumption of this material in public places. Because often in those, some of those nations, people don't have their own bedrooms. They don't live in big homes, everyone has privacy. So where do they consume such filthy material? In public. It's actually very well known. And they don't have PCs and iMacs and iPads and all that. Not everyone has it, it's on a phone. Phone is consumed in public or in close public quarters. Prophet has told us this is all Akhiru Zaman. Oh, by the way, the lowest obesity countries are Tanzania, Japan, and those other countries. They're at the bottom. Ethiopia, a lot of African countries there. And Japan is in there too. So someone can be modernized and have a low obesity rate. Salu ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. Tonight, we remember the one who looked the most like the Prophet. The one who most resembled the Messenger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The one who was raised by the most dignified father, by the most courageous father, by the most beautiful father, by the father whose soul is a zinat to alameen, is an ornament to the world, and that is none other than Hussein ibn Ali. Hussein is now left with his family. And it is time for Banu Hashim to come forward. And the swords are being sharpened for war, and all they could hear is al-atash, al-atash, al-atash. Thirst, thirst, thirst. They say Ali Akbar, according to the majority of scholars, was in his mid-20s. He had Hamza's might, Haydar's bravery, and the Prophet's beauty. He represented the light of the Ahlul Bayt. I'll narrate to you a riwaya that one day Imam al-Hussein was passing by the Qasr of Bani Muqatil. He had his head down and he said, "Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un. Alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen." He said this 3 times. From God we come, to Him we return. Ali Akbar was with him, and he turns to his father and he says, "Are you reciting verses about the return to Allah?" He says, "Ya Bunayya." He said, "Oh my son." Ali Akbar put his head down as his father spoke to him. Look at the respect between father and son. Right? We spoke about the munafiqun, now we're speaking about the greatest servants of Allah. The father is speaking and the son is sitting in honor of the father. And Hussein ibn Ali says that the people are traveling and their dreams or their visions are traveling towards them, meaning that he saw something about what would happen in Karbala. Hussein was in deep thought. He said, Ali Akbar now understood what Abu Abdullah was saying. He says, Alasna alal haq. Oh Father, are we not on the truth? The Father tells the Son, Bala, we are on the truth. Ali Akbar then tells Hussein ibn Ali, his father, this is the true relationship between father and son that we're talking about, huh? This is how to raise boys. The boy tells the father, the young boy tells the father, Ali Akbar tells his father, well then in that case I have no fear of death. Father, if you tell us we are on truth, then I have no fear of maut. Abu Abdullah took so much pride in this child. In fact, Umar ibn Sa'd offered protection to Ali Akbar because of his mother Layla had a connection to Banu Umayyah. Ali Akbar was the first from Banu Hashim. As-salamu alayka ya awwala qatil min naslin khayr as-salim. Right? Imam al-Zaman says that this was one of the first from Banu Hashim to go. He comes to his father asking his father to fight. Hussein does not refuse Ali Akbar. Ali Akbar looked at his father and Hussein looked at Ali Akbar, Abu Abdullah. وَأَرْخَى عَيْنَي بِالْدُمُوءِ. And his eyes filled with tears. And he said, Wallah, I testify that to these people, that this young boy represents most the Messenger of Allah. He resembles the most the Messenger of Allah. In his language, in his physical appearance, خَلْقًا وَخُلُقًا وَمَنْتَقًا بِرَسُولِكَ. He says, Allahumma famna'hum barakat al-ard. Oh Allah, deny these oppressors the blessings of the earth. Oh Allah, tear them up, all of them. Oh Allah, let them never be happy again, for they invited us here, and now they are here to kill us. Thumma addu alayna wa yuqatiluna. The Imam felt betrayed. All the Ashab were gone. Banu Hashim was now ready to give their own life. What was transpiring in the mind of Hussein, Allah only knows. But it's reported that his mother Layla and some of the other women began begging Ali Akbar to stay. After all, he grew up in their lap as a child. They began saying, Irham ma'ala ghurbatina. Have mercy on our loneliness, O Ali. We cannot live without you. We cannot bear to live without you, O Ali Akbar. We are lonely without you. La tasta'jil. Do not rush out into battle, O Ali. What does Hussein do now? He dresses his son up for war in the armor and the turban of Amir al-Mu'mineen. In his father's armor, Hussein gives Ali Akbar one of his horses. Ali Akbar now goes forth to fight. Ali Akbar now goes out into battle. Ana Ali ibn al-Husayn, nahnu wa baytullah awla bin nabi. He's reciting the poetry of war. He's introducing to the enemies who he is. I am Ali, the son of Hussein. We are from the family of the Prophet. Wallahi la yahkumu fina ibn da'i. That this illegitimate person will not rule over us. We will never be ruled by this illegitimate person. The riwayah states that as Ali Akbar went out to fight, Imam al-Hussein had tears and began to cry. Look at the softness of the qalb of the heart of Hussein ibn Ali. When Umar ibn Sa'd saw him, he shouted at Umar ibn Sa'd. He said, what is wrong with you? May Allah cut off your lineage, just as you have cut off mine. May Allah send someone to slay you in your own bed, in your own firash. Hussein then says, Inna Allah istafa Adama wa Nuha wa Al Ibrahima wa Al Imrana ala al alameen. He begins reciting the ayah of Quran that Allah has chosen Adam and Nuh and the family of Ibrahim and the family of Imran. Ali Akbar continues to fight. He killed 120 men. By now the thirst was killing him. Due to the riwayah states, due to the heat and the weapons, he was exhausted. He now rides back to his father. covered in wounds, comes back to Abu Abdullah. He says, Ya Aba, al-Atash qad qatalani. That, oh my father, the thirst is killing me. وَالثِّقْلُ الْهَدِيلَ اجْحَدَنِي. And the weight of the iron is overcoming me. هَلِلُ شُرْبَةٍ مِّن مَاءٍ سَبِيلٍ. Is there any way for water, oh my father? How was Abu Abdullah to answer? What was the jawab of Imam al-Hussein? Shall I relate to you? Wallah, today I had tears in my eyes when I read this bil Arabi. Bin ayna atika bil ma ya bunayya. Where will I get pani? Where will I get water for you, oh my son? Abu Abdullah had nothing to give Ali Akbar. He says, where will I get water for you, oh my son? Wa Husayna, wa Imama, fabakka al-Husayn. Husayn begins to cry. He says, you will meet your grandfather quickly, oh my son. Khawarizmi reports. He now asks Ali Akbar to put out his tongue. He took out his ring. He put the ring in the mouth of Ali Akbar. Allah knows only the secrets of Aima Tahreen, of why they are doing this. Ali Akbar now goes back out to fight. He's fighting like a lion. He managed to kill another 80 opponents. How the heart of Abu Abdullah must have been palpitating. He says, war has now confronted us with its realities. He fought 200 men. Then they fired an arrow. Shall I narrate to you where the arrow landed, Mu'minin? Mu'minin, shall you know where the arrow landed? The arrow landed in the throat of Ali al-Akbar. Then they began stabbing him. Then they stabbed him in his back. Alayhi salam. They're now cutting him from every side. Ya Allah. Ya Allah. Salamu alayka ya sahib al-zaman. He now, the riwayah states, when he was about to die, lama balagat ruhu wa taraqi, when his soul reached the top of his throat, what did he say? Rafi'ani began screaming, Ya Aba, Ya Aba, Ya Abata, Assalamu alayka, alayka minni salam. Ya Abata, hadha jaddi Rasulullah. This is my grandfather Rasulullah. He has given me water. I will never suffer thirst again, oh my father. Abu Faraj al-Isfahani then tells us they continue to fire arrows at him. Hussein now races out into battle. And he's screaming, Waladi Ali, Waladi Ali. Oh my son Ali. Oh my son Ali, oh my son Ali. Hussein comes to the body of Ali al-Akbar. He throws himself onto the body of Ali al-Akbar. No one could hear until now the cries of Hussein. Hussein began crying, Qatalallahu qawmu qataluk. May Allah kill those who killed you. Ala dunya ba'daka al-afa. This world is worthless without you, oh my son. But the riwayah doesn't end there. Hussein now has to bring the body back to the tent. The Arbab al-Maqatil, the books of Maqatil tell us that a woman came running out and her face was shining like the moon. And she began to scream, Waliya! 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 She is screaming, Wa Aliya! And then the Rawi asks, who is this woman screaming? Who is this woman screaming? They say, Hadihi Zainab bint Ali. This is Zainab bint Ali screaming. Umm Kulthum comes out. She's screaming, Wa Aliya! Wa Aliya! Hussein man is looking at the women. He doesn't know what to say. He takes Ali Akbar into the fustat, into the tent. وَوَدَعَهُ فِي هِجْرِ And he puts him into his lap. And he's sitting there. وَوَدَعَهُ خَدُّهُ عَلَى خَدِّهِ And he put his cheek onto his cheek. He began kissing his body. He began wiping the turab from his face. Speaking to his son. And then he looks at the entry of the tent. He sees a little girl. A little girl standing at the tent. Who is this little girl? هذه سكينة بنت الحسين. Sakina is standing there. She looks at Hussein. Hussein looks at Sakina. Hussein has no words to tell her. What is he to say? She begins to run. Hussein grabs her arm. He puts her into his lap. And he says, Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un. Sabran, sabran. Matam Hussein, Matam Hussein.
Hussein, Hussein. Hussein, Hussein. Hussein, Hussein. Hussein, Hussein. Hussein, Hussein. Hussein, Hussein. Hussein, Hussein. Hussein, Hussein. Hussein, Hussein.
Zakhm dil ke dikhaun main kaise Zakhm dil ke dikhaun main kaise Tera laasha uthaun main kaise Akbar mera seher wala Akbar, Akbar, mera seher wala Laashe Akbar pe shah jab pahunche Dil ko haathon se thaam kar bole Teri furqat ne Ali Akbar Aag dil mein mere laga di hai Aag dil ki bujhaun main kaise Aag dil ki bujhaun main kaise Tera laasha uthaun main kaise Akbar Mera seheryan wala Akbar, Akbar Mera seheryan Tu hai kadi al jawan hai beta baap tera zaif hai kitna noor aankhon ka ho gaya ruksaat mujhko aata nahi nazar khaima leke khaimo main jaau main kaise leke khaimo main jaau main kaise tera laasha uthaun main kaise akbar mera seheryan wala akbar akbar mera seheryan jisne 18 saal pala tha kaise dekhe gi wo tera laasha teri shaadi jise arma kaise jale gi wo tera sadma teri maa ko bataun main kaise teri maa ko bataun main kaise tera laasha uthaun main kaise akbar mera seheryan wala akbar akbar mera seheryan bhai behnon ka hai ajab rishta jiska sani kahin nahi milta ro ke sughra ne ye लिखा अकबर एक दुखिया की लाज रख लेना, मर गया तू बताओ मैं कैसे, मर गया तू बताओ मैं कैसे, तेरा लाशा उठाओ मैं कैसे अकबर, मेरा शहर वाला अकबर अकबर, मेरा शहर वाला अकबर।
हुसैन 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 हुसैन
हुसैन
हुसैन हुसैन हुसैन हुसैन
ज़बीह कर्बला शबीह सरवर, ओ आवर हीरो अली अकबर, ज़बीह कर्बला शबीह सरवर,
ज़बीह कर्बला शबीह सरवर, ओ आवर हीरो अली अकबर।
You have accomplished your destination.
nation.
But never ending for Ibn Zahra is imtihane
Ali Akbar. Sayyid Hussein, Sayyid Hussein, Sayyid Hussein, Sayyid Hussein, Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. Inshallah, please.